Hey, this is Andrew over to FCP Euro. Today I'm going to show you how to install a steering rack on my E82 128. This procedure is going to work for all rear-wheel drive 1 series and 3 series vehicles without active steering. During the video I'm going to talk a little bit about active steering, but it should be pretty close. So there are a few different symptoms that you can notice from a bad steering rack. If you're getting any leaking from the rack itself, one of the big symptoms that drew me to replace the steering rack is this noise. That is play inside the rack between the pinion gear and the rack itself. In an ideal situation, in a perfectly working rack, there's gonna be no noise when rocking the wheel back and forth. Any play in the steering, so you know, brand new BMW should feel really sharp, should feel really direct. If you're feeling like there's a dead spot, or you know, you need to turn a little bit further, a little bit farther to get that input, it's a really good idea to look into the steering rack, as well as wandering. That's the most common thing that you're going to notice right off the bat. You're driving down the highway, it's a beautiful sunny day, and the car is just kind of meandering in the lane a little bit. You know, maybe what you'd feel if it was really windy out. That's coming from play in the interface inside the rack. It's a really good idea to look into it and replace it if it's necessary. So this job isn't too bad. Book time on it is about 3 hours. I'd certainly put aside the whole day just in case, but pretty straightforward. So we've got the steering rack itself. We've got our supporting hardware. All of this hardware is stretched to yield. Aluminum hardware, so you want to replace it. This kit does include all of the hardware, all of the gaskets that you're going to need. The hardest part, I think, is going to be trying to get this steering shaft out. It is kind of tight against the firewall. Might need to borrow a friend with small hands to get in there, but we'll be sure to show you that in the video. You're also going to need a pretty big catch pan. We're going to siphon out the fluid out of the top of the reservoir, get as much as we can once we pull the airbox out, but you are going to get some leakage when you pull the return line and pressure line out of the rack itself. That's going to drip down to the subframe, so you want to make sure that you catch all of that. You're looking at about 8 bolts total, though they are in some tricky places. So we've gone over all of the parts that you're going to be installing today. Let's take a look at the tools you're going to need to do it. Okay, so here are all the tools you're going to need. As you can see, not too bad. We've got a few open-end wrenches, we've got a few sockets, a couple of extensions, torque wrench, you're definitely going to want to use that. Socket take off the wheels. There is a special tool to take off the clamps that we're going to use. We're going to fake it with some channel locks. I'll show you how to do that. You also might need a couple of pry bars, channel locks, diagonal cutters, and a good size hammer. The ratcheting E20 is also helpful. But yeah, pretty straightforward. And if you want a full list of the tools here, we will have a link in the description so that you know exactly what you need before you get started. Without any further ado, let's get to it. We are going to start by removing the airbox. That's going to be 2 10-millimeter bolts over on the driver's side of the vehicle. Okay, so once you've got those 10-millimeter bolts out, you're going to want to disconnect your mass airflow sensor and loosen the outer hose clamp on the intake tube. To take the mass airflow sensor off, I just have a little flathead screwdriver. You want to very gently lift up the tab. It's pretty delicate, so be gentle with it. Once that's unplugged, kind of move it to the side. Then you can use that same flathead screwdriver or a 6-millimeter socket. To just get down here on the clamp itself. I prefer a socket, just flatheads tend to round. They can be a bit of a pain. So once you've got that loose, you don't need to completely undo it. Just get it so it's not clamping anymore. You can take that same screwdriver, disconnect the intake tube here to the front of the car. There's just 2 little tabs. I'm going to move it over there. Then you can take the box, just give it a little wiggle, and it'll come right out of the car. From there, you're going to want to completely remove the rest of the intake tube. There's another 6-millimeter bolt right behind the power steering reservoir. This one you can use a long socket or that flathead. It is a little buried back here, so just be a little gentle. Again, does not have to be completely undone, just a little loosened, give it a wiggle, come right out. So now you've got a pretty clear shot to the steering rack itself, you can see both the return line and the pressure line, as well as that steering shaft moving up to the steering column itself. We're also going to replace and remove the reservoir. We're going to do that next. Just make sure you have as few things in your way as possible, as well as you can see the leaking all around here. Getting a new reservoir, getting a new cap can help that leaking for the future. So from here, we are going to drain the power steering reservoir. We're going to use a super fancy CTA fluid extractor. You can use a turkey baster, anything like that, just to bring as much fluid out as possible, make as little of a mess once you get underneath to actually take the rack out. So remove your cap. Make sure we don't drip any. It's also a really good idea to clean this area. If you're not going to replace this reservoir, make sure that no dirt gets inside. Any dirt inside of the system is going to prematurely wear things and cause them to fail sooner than you want them to. So once that is undone, you're going to want to remove the clamps here. These are traditional BMW style clamps. They do need to be pried apart. There's a little back hook on them that you need to get undone. So if you just kind of get your flathead screwdriver in here, give them a little wiggle. You can get underneath in between the lower and outer section. This can take a little bit of wiggling, but shouldn't be too bad. You're basically prying apart the looped section just to create a little bit more play in there, and then it will come right undone. Just like that. And as you can see, these will break every time. It's impossible to save them. So we do include both of these in the kit. So from here, I would get a little cup or a bucket. You can set it right where that air box used to be. We're going to disconnect both of these hoses. And when you disconnect each one, just kind of tip it over into the bucket. You want to get as close to the power steering pump as possible. That's just, again, going to get as much fluid out of the system as possible, so you're going to have less of a mess later. From here, we're going to remove the upper cowling. This is where the filter for your air conditioning is going to be. Make sure that you get good air into your car. But by removing this, you get a lot more access to the back of the engine. It's going to make it a little bit easier for us to reach the top of the steering shaft. So these covers come off either side. They are just little push clips, nothing special there. There is a little sensor here for, I believe it's ambient air temp. That's just a little clip. I'm gonna push that off. I always forget to take this off and I end up hyperextending this cord, which you definitely don't wanna break. And then from there, these are just 8mm little self-tapping screws. There's one on each corner, and two across the top here, and four across the top of the filter. Okay. So once you have those 8 screws out of the top, you want to disconnect this electrical harness. Just give it a little bit of a tug, it'll come down, as well as the one behind it. And those just rest on the top of the engine. And then this is going to lift up, a little bit of wiggle, it'll come right out. So as you can see, once that's out, you've got a lot more room to get to the back here. And that steering shaft is hidden right down, right about here. Little hands will get you back there, no big deal. From there, now we're going to release those hoses that we talked about earlier. You can use a flathead or a little pick. Sometimes they are a little sticky. They will require some wiggling. Make sure to keep this bolted so you can kind of wiggle against it. So you can get a pick or a flathead and just kind of gently weasel this around to get this hose loose. This car's got about 130,000 miles on it, so this hose has been on here for a little while. There you go. That just comes loose. This is where you're going to bring in your cup. Just set this down here by the air box, where the air box was. You're gonna get a little bit of fluid out of there. Just try to catch it. And then take that hose, just bring it over here, and get as much of that fluid out as you can. Perfect. And then do the same thing with the second hose. Just be very gentle if you're using a hook tool. You don't want to get yourself or damage the hose itself. A little bit of a wiggle, that'll come right off. And then just be ready with your catch can once you pull it off, because you are going to get just a little bit more fluid out of there. Once that's slowed down, same deal. Get your bottle as low as you can. Just get as much fluid out of here as possible. Not going to be able to get all of it, but any little bit helps. Okay. You can grab a rag here. Just try to get the rest of this so it's not dripping down everywhere. You can take both of these hoses and just kind of pull them out of the way. You can zip tie them up to the line, get a little bit of string. And from here, you can remove these two 10 mils. That reservoir is going to come out. There's also a 10 mil on this side. You are going to have to save the bracket. The kit is only coming with the reservoir itself. That just pulls up and you're done. So from here, you are going to go to the inside of the car, take off the lower kick panel so that you can get to the lower half of your steering column. Your steering wheel obviously is telescopic, and that shaft that slides inside of the column can move. So what you have to do is take the kick panel off and brace it from the inside, so that way when you're reinstalling the steering shaft and you're playing with it, moving it around, the steering column doesn't move inside the car, and that'll be a little bit of a pain to make sure that everything's aligned. You can either use a tool like a stick or a pry, we'll show you that, or you can have a friend hold it as you're playing with it. Obviously, you only need it as you're disconnecting and reconnecting. It's not going to move as the car is just sitting there. So now that we're on the inside of the car, before we take those lower panel screws out, we have to move the steering wheel to the full upright and back position. So you're just going to loosen the lever here, get that all the way up, all the way back, which I was pretty close, and then just tighten that right back down. Now you're going to move down to the panel, which is right around the pedals. It's the lowest panel, not this one down here. There's about 5 or 6 screws. We'll show you that right now. So to addition to the screws, there's a little tab here. Give that a wiggle, and that is going to come right down and out. There is a light here. You just want to disconnect that. That comes out just like that. And from here, this is going to give you access to the bottom of the shaft going down to the steering shaft. So you can see that right here. Here's your boot. Here's your steering shaft. Let's see if we can get some light in there. And you just got to make sure that, so here is your U-joint right here, attaches to the bottom of the steering shaft. You just have to make sure that this doesn't move. You can get a bit of wood, brace it against this joint here, or you can have a friend hold it. But basically, that's your telescoping for the steering wheel itself. You just got to make sure that that doesn't move, otherwise you got to force and feed this back through. Okay, so now we are going to disconnect the upper part of the steering shaft. It is a really tight fit. We're going to get in here with a light to show you. So the bolt that you're trying to undo is just below the brake lines. I'll try to get under here. It's right there. It is an E10. It is a little tricky, so there's a couple ways to approach this. An E10 on a quarter inch ratchet with no extension will get in there, or if you want to remove this bar, you can get in from the top with a 3/8 ratchet on an E10. Just kind of move these brake lines. They do have a little bit of wiggle. Don't wrench on them too hard, but you will be able to get them out of the way. Or if you have a ratcheting wrench, with an E10 on it. That's what I'm going to use right now. You can get in from right underneath the heater core lines. There's a fair amount of room here. It's just a little tight in between the firewall. So we'll show you that right now. We also have JR in the car. The reason that we took that interior panel off, the steering column is telescoping, so we just need him on the inside to hold the inside of the steering shaft so that it can't move into the column so that we can easily disconnect and reconnect. So let's get to that. So here's the tool that I'm using. It's a gear wrench E10 ratcheting. It's just dual direction ratcheting. That's going to slide right underneath the heater core lines and should loosen it right up. This bolt does have to come completely out because it is grooved on the steering shaft because it can only go in one way. So you'll be ratcheting here for a little bit, unfortunately. So we have taken the screw out of the top of the steering shaft. Now we're going to remove the lower screw and move that steering shaft up. That's going to allow it to release from the steering rack itself. Once it is moved up, then we'll be able to release it from the top. Let's go in there. So your steering shaft is right here. It's continuing down from the firewall down to about here. So we're just going to take our E10, put it right on, the steering shaft, just like that. Okay. Once you get that loose, just need a couple more turns. It's going to come right out. So from here, you're going to move the steering shaft up towards the steering column. You're going to use the telescoping to allow it to move up. That'll disconnect it from the steering rack itself. If you see on the steering rack, there is a black plastic ring, and that points to a little tab. That is your centering tab. That means that your steering wheel's straight, means that your rack is in the neutral position. You want to make sure to try to keep that as straight as possible, the steering wheel in the car and the steering rack in the centering position. That will make your life a lot easier when you have to put all this back together, and we'll show you the alignment gauge on the new rack as well. Okay, so we have all the bolts out here. Just because it is such a tight spline and you've got, you know, road grime and grit and dirt in there, it's not wanting to come loose from the steering rack. So we've got a hammer and a little impact tool here. See if we can knock some of that grime out. We're also going to spray some peanut butter blaster, some, you know, anti-corrosive, try to loosen up some of that dirt and grime as well. As you can see here, this is an example of the fluid leaking. This is a section of the steering rack right where it meets the pinion. We've got some leakage there as well as from the hard lines just behind it. That's definitely attributing to the failure of the rack here. So we put the car up in the air. We're going to take the wheels and the belly pan off. So here's an image of the U-joint from the bottom. It was pretty rusty. It was pretty stuck on there. What we ended up doing is grabbing a punch and putting it on the underside of the U-joint from above the sway bar at the front. And as you can see, it's most of the way off now. But basically, we went right through here. There's a hole above the steering rack, above the sway bar that goes right up to that U-joint. You get a really good view of it from right through here. And then you just tap that straight up, and that's going to get that loose without too much trouble. So we'll put that back on here like this, and then just give that we'll give that a couple taps and it comes right off the end. And then from there, we're gonna pull it. We're gonna bring the car back down, and we're going to pull it from the top forward to get that upper section off. If we take a look right down through here, we've disconnected the lower part of the steering shaft from the steering rack. You can see there's the end right there. And then that's going to continue up into the column here. So I've got Evan, our staff writer here, holding onto the steering wheel as a little bit of a counter hold. And then from there, you can just straighten the shaft, give it a pull, and it comes right off. So obviously the top section here, a lot less grime, a lot less road salt, came right undone. This bottom section, you can see lots of rust, lots of corrosion, lots of road salt in there. So it's a little bit tricky to get off. This is another excellent example of why you want to replace this. You can see this is all marred up and hit from us trying to get it out. So there's that part right there. So now that we have that steering shaft out, we're going to put the car back in the air, disconnect the tie rods, and drop that steering rack down. So right now we're going to do our outer tie rods. We're going to start with the inner bolt on the gator here. That's the clamp. And then we're going to do the outer. This is a great time to, right before you start doing this, you're going to want to measure where your tie rod sits. So your tie rod is what sets your alignment and sets your toe and steering angle. So you want to measure how many threads you have exposed here so that you can put it back exactly where it was. So we're going to measure the number of threads. We're also going to measure from center of the tie rod to the end of the threads on both sides. So that way we can make sure to put, when we put either the new tie rods on, or if you're reusing your old tie rods, these were replaced about 6 months ago, so they're still pretty good. You know exactly where they are, and you're going to be really close on your alignment when you put it all back together, because you are going to have to drive it to an alignment shop to make sure that everything's perfect. So let's get the measuring tape out, write down those measurements, and then we'll loosen these up. So we've got our tape measure here. We're going to measure our tie rods. Pretty simple. You just go to the end of the threads here and then measure as close as you possibly can to the center of the tie rod. So I'm right in that first thread, and I'm going to say that is 65 millimeters on the driver's side. We're also, just for giggles, going to measure to here, and that is about 19 millimeters. That's on the passenger side. Exact same thing on this side. Just put that tape measure in that first groove. Get to the center as best you can. Also about 65. So we know that this rack is right in that center position, and our measurements are good. So now we are going to loosen the gaiters on the tie rods. Just make that a little bit easier while it's on the car, so you have something to fight against. These don't have too much torque on them, so loosen them up. You can see that's really all you need. Go over to this side, same deal.
A little tighter?
A little bit. Cool. So that's all you need. Now we're going to take off the 19 mil bolts, or 21 actually, on the ends there. So these are OE Lemforder control arms. They are counter-held with a T40. So what you're going to need is a combination wrench to go over the top like that, and then you're going to need your T40 to counter-hold it once you get it loose. So your initial turn, that can be just open, but what you want to do is prevent the ball joint here from rotating inside of its socket. So you're going to need that that counter hold. This is just a quarter inch. Shouldn't need too much effort once you break it loose. So you can just kind of grab the back of the caliper. Just be careful of your wear sensor, just so the car doesn't turn on you. And then that's going to come loose. Should play pretty nice. So now that we've made a couple turns, you can see, if you want to zoom in right in here, you can see that lower rotating, that entire assembly is rotating. That's when you're going to start to need your counter hold. So we have our quarter inch T40, got our 21 over the top. So we're just going to put the counter hold in there, make sure it's in the correct position, and then you can just work against it. In a perfect world, we'd have a ratcheting wrench here, but unfortunately with the shape of the knuckle, the ratcheting wrench didn't want to fit. So it's really not too much force. Just make sure that you keep that T40 well seated in there, because you don't want it rounded out. These tie rods are only maybe 6 months old. They made it through a Connecticut winter. They're already starting to get some surface rust on those threads, making it pretty tough to remove this bolt. I said our kit includes new tie rods, again, for this exact same reason. You're fighting threads, might as well replace them. They're only about 50 bucks a piece, and you know you're going to be good for a long time. So you can see that's the there's a nylock on the threads, as well as you can see that little bit of rust there. It's all it takes to make it a little bit tough.
Did that do it?
Impact gun makes that a lot easier. So now we've got the tie rods out and loose, we're going to do the return and pressure lines. So we are going to disconnect the return and pressure lines. That's going to be a 22 millimeter socket and a 19 millimeter socket, respectively. You can reach right through here just over the top of the rack. They're really easy to touch just right there. So not much torque on these. They come loose pretty easily. Big hardware, but not very tight at all. You are going to get some power steering fluid to leak out of here. I would recommend getting a bucket, some cardboard. We're going to grab our big catch can to catch that.
Can you just slack him and tell him Matt's on DIY duty, waiting for the fluid to get back?
Yeah. So here's your fluid leaking. Like I said, you want to get that catch can to grab that. You really only need an eighth turn, maybe. Then these are going to come out by hand. So there's the smaller one. And here's your bigger one. There are two gaskets, one on each side. So it is a banjo style bolt. So you've got a gasket. Oops. You've got a gasket on the bolt head side, and then on the other side of the banjo, there's going to be a gasket. Make sure you grab both of those off of the car. You don't want to double up the gaskets. So we have the power steering lines undone. Now we're just doing the main two rack bolts here. This is going to be an E12 underneath and a 16 millimeter hex head nut on the top. So you can go right over top of the subframe. There's lots of room here in between the engine and the subframe to put that counter hold on there. You're going to put your E12. That'll come right out and done. Again, these are aluminum stretch bolts, so the torque's not too high. It will play nice. So I'm going to leave this bolt in on this side as I go for the other side. Once we loosen these two bolts, the rack is completely loose. You don't want it to come and fall on your head. So just be very wary of that as you take out that second bolt. So same concept here. I think it's a little easier to go from the front to counter hold this, just like that. Again, you can see this bolt starting to come loose. Do be wary that this rack doesn't come down on you. So I've got that undone except for just a couple threads. I'm gonna get my wrenches out of here and make sure I can get a hand on it before it comes down. So then from here, we're just going to unthread the last couple threads by hand. And then make sure you get a hand on it, wiggle it. A little wiggle and she'll come down. So I actually forgot to disconnect this power line here. It is a 10 mil, you can get to it. Another open end right from the top. That comes right undone. And your steering rack comes down, and then just try to support this power line on the subframe. So we'll set that down, and then we're just gonna tuck this up like that so it doesn't fall. Just to put as little stress on the lines as we can. And that is a removed steering rack. Not too bad. And it is dripping everywhere, so I'm gonna set it down. So we've got the new rack here. As you can see, much shinier, much less fluid leaking, obviously. Before you put it back in, you wanna remove these two plastic plugs. And as you can see here, here's your alignment plate. That's going to line up with the steering shaft. You want to make sure that this little arrow is lined up with that centering tab. That's going to make sure that the rack is in its center position and that everything is going to line up when you put it back in. So that easily spins by hand to make sure that's lined up. And then just as this came out, it's going to slide right into these tabs, just like the old one came out. Should play pretty nice. That goes in just like that. And then we can put our bracket goes right onto there. And that's it. So now you're going to put your line back in. There is a alignment hole in the tab. And then just that 10 millimeter bolt is going to go back in. Goes in just like that. From there, you can grab your two bolts that go through the subframe and up with your 16 millimeter nuts that thread onto the top. Okay, so once you get the rack in place, you can put these lines in. You're gonna wanna get new washers. They're included in the kit. Obviously the bigger washers are for the bigger nut. So one on each side of the flange. Make sure to not get any dirt in here because these are gonna be in your final product into the rack. Make sure to get your gaskets on either side and thread those in. So we have the power steering lines connected, but they're not torqued yet. Now we've got nice access to these lower bolts. They're going to be torqued to 56 newton meters plus 90 degrees. You're going to need your 16 millimeter counter hold. You can snug them up by hand, just with the socket, get them just till they stop turning. And then once that's done, you're gonna wanna grab your torque wrench. This is not a tremendous amount of force, so you should get a click pretty quick. There's your click. Then you're going to go 90 degrees past that. So next we're going to torque the pressure lines. These are two different hardwares. The return line, which is the smaller one, is going to be 30 newton meters. The larger one is going to be 35. So still pretty low. So get out your torque wrench. That's all it is. I did just the first one. Now we're going to adjust our torque wrench up to 35. And we're going to do the bigger one. And that is all you need for that one. Cool. Next, we're going to put on our tie rod ends. So remember, we measured those before. They were at 65 centimeters. We're going to go ahead and thread on each side. Make sure you get your left and your right correct when you take them off the other rack. And then we'll just tighten those down. So we're going to thread these on to the measurement that we had in before we took the rack off and tighten them down. And that is at our 65 millimeter measurement. So now we can put the tie rod back in the knuckle, put the nut back on, and tighten it down. So that goes on just like that. We'll double check our measurement. That is perfect. Then you can also tighten this guy down at that same time. So this is when you're going to tighten the gaiter on the tie rod and your tie rod ball joint nut. This is going to be 121 Newton meters. This is going to be 40 Newton meters. So not too bad. You do want to replace these nuts, whether you're replacing the tie rods or not. They are a pretty high torque, and they have a nylon locking ring in them. They are one-time use. Not spinning. You're going to use a T40 as your counter hold. And then your open-end wrench goes over top. Okay, so we've got our torque wrench here. We're going to tighten these tie rod ends to 165 Newton meters. That is over 100 foot-pounds, so you want to make sure you get a good purchase on it. So like on the other side, we're going to measure our tie rod end, make sure that we get that aligned properly before we put our outside nut on. So we have our nut tightened down by hand. I'm gonna grab our torque wrench and tighten that down to 165 Newton meters. So the reason that we've got JR in the car, basically, if you can see down in there, that is the bottom of the steering column. It's the spline drive that this shaft is going to go over. And we need him to kind of push against from the inside so that we can get this spline over all those drives and make sure that we can get it in properly. So we're going to attempt to do that. Can go back towards you a little bit, JR. More. Okay, now back towards me. All right, can you do a rotate clockwise? Keep going. All right, go back. Keep going. Keep going. There it is. All right, give it a good push there. All you got. Cool. Cool. All right, that's good.
Are we
good? Yep, you're good. That's it. We have our new hardware here. It comes with Loctite already. As you can see, aluminum stretch bolts, you do want to replace them. The old ones come out. They're pretty gross. They're really corroded. You definitely want to get them in there. But you can also see, it's kind of hard to see, but this taper in the middle, that's the stretch to yield. And you can't do that twice. If you try to tighten them again, they're gonna snap. You're gonna be in here doing it again. So both sides of the steering shaft have a groove that they sit in the that these bolts have to go through. Basically, it's a centering hole. So you wanna make sure that both on the top and the bottom, you are putting that screw through the centering hole. It is a little hard to see, but this is your best angle right from the top. Hear that nice positive as it slides right in there. Now you want to get your wrench on there, snug it down. And with several extensions, we're able to get onto that bolt. This is going to be tightened. This is going to be tightened to 24 Newton meters. So very, very little on here. That's all she takes. So your other side, That can be seen right from the top. It's going to go right in like that. This may take just a little bit of wiggling. You gotta make sure that you are all the way in that groove. So just like that. It's gonna be right up flush with the top of the plastic alignment bolt or alignment gauge here. And it's gonna go right through across 24 Newton meters on that one as well. And we're gonna use our regular 3/8 ratchet just to snug it down, just cause it is kind of a tight space. Once we get close to those 24 Newton meters, then we'll grab the torque wrench. All right, we're just starting to get a little bit of purchase on this. So we'll do just a little bit there, then we'll grab our torque wrench. And there's that 24 Newton meters. Really not too much. That Loctite's gonna hold it just fine. So from here, we're gonna replace this old, messy, worn out reservoir. We're gonna replace it with this new unit from Bosch ZF. And you can see here, this is a ZF unit, but it has the BMW logo right on it. This is the exact same part that you're gonna get in a dealer's box if you went to pick this up from a dealer for a lot more. So first thing we have to do is remove this bracket. We're gonna remove the bracket and swap it over to here so that way we can get it to mount nice on there. The bracket is held on by a 10 millimeter bolt. Very, very low torque. Once you take the bolt out, it slides right out. And you can put that right over the old one like that. Get your bolt and just start the threads. You're going to want to leave this loose because you're going to need to rotate this to get the hoses in the perfect position. But you can set that where it goes, just like that. And then as you can see, you can give it a rotate to make sure that your hoses are exactly where you want them to be. You don't want them to be kinked or stressed in any way. So it's pretty natural where they go. Your lower hose is going to come from the top line and it's gonna go right in there. As you can see, you obviously don't want them to cross, so they go pretty straightforward there. You're gonna take off these plugs. This time you also wanna grab your new clamps. There is a bigger one and a smaller one. Smaller one is for the bottom, bigger one's for the top. You need to put the clamps on before you install them over the reservoir. Hose number one, hose number two, just like that. And then, like I said, just give this a little twist, kind of see where it falls naturally, and just make sure that everything stays aligned. Then you can tighten up this 10 millimeter bolt in the back. So very low torque on these, just enough so that it's not, if we hold this steady, just enough so it can't rotate and it can't rattle. So once you have the clamp over, it's still pretty loose. You have to put a pair of diagonal cutters or the tool for these. Basically, this needs to be crimped and that's what pulls everything tight. Make sure that you don't get any leaks. I'll show you with the tool that you need. It's a CTA tool that we have. This is CTA tool 4210. Of course, I can't fit it in there. But basically what it does is it grabs either side of this little bulb, squeezes it, and mats it down. And that's just going to make sure that that can't go anywhere. For the lower one, because I'm off on the angle, we're just going to use a set of channel locks. Or diagonal cutters. We're going to use a set of diagonal cutters, and you're just going to give that a squeeze, and that just firms everything up, make sure that it's not going to come loose. So from there, we can put the power steering reservoir back in its home. If you want to right now, you can also add your two 10 millimeter bolts at the top here. That'll just prevent this from moving around. So that's back in. Now you can put your airbox back in, and then we're going to bleed the power steering system. So you're going to put your two 10 millimeter bolts back in. You're going to plug your mass airflow sensor back in. And you're going to use your 6 millimeter or your flathead to tighten the two hose clamps. So everything's back together. Now we can put power steering fluid in the reservoir, bleed the system, make sure we don't have any faults. Okay, so on your first pour, you're going to want to fill the reservoir about 10 millimeters over the full line. This is supposed to be done at 68 degrees Fahrenheit, which is the operating temperature of the system. So once it's full to here, now you're going to get in, turn the car to accessory, turn the steering wheel. That's going to start cycling fluid through the system. You're going to prime your pump. You're going to get fluid into the rack itself. So we're going to put the key in the ignition. We're going to turn the wheel from lock to lock to make sure we don't get an airbag warning light. That's basically ensuring that everything's aligned as it should be and you're not getting a clock spring error with the airbag. So we have no warning lights there, so we're good to go. I'm going to keep turning the wheel just to prime that system, basically get fluid through the whole thing before we turn the car on, get the power steering pump involved. We don't want cavitation, we don't want air in that pump. So we're just going to give this a couple turns back and forth. And keep checking the fluid after we do this. We are now going to start the car. That's going to get the power steering pump going. We're going to turn the steering wheel lock to lock twice, turn the engine back off, and check the level again. You can hear all that noise is air in the lines. We're going to have to keep adding fluid until we prime all of that out. On the second round, the level went down a fair amount. So again, we're going to keep adding fluid until we get that up to where we need it to be. As you can hear, the whine from the steering pump is gone. We're getting most of the air out of the system. We're going to do this one more time, checking the fluid, make sure everything's at level, and then we should be pretty close to button the rest of it back up. So after our third time bleeding the reservoir and bleeding the pump, we've used almost an entire liter of Pentosan CHF11S, which is the OE fluid that came in this car. You always want to check your reservoir cap. Some cars have ATF in them, some cars have CHF11. 99% of the time it's CHF11, that's the newest version, but it's always a good idea to check. It's going to be written right on the cap itself. Now that we've got everything buttoned up top, we're going to put this underbelly pan back on, get everything buttoned, we'll throw the wheels back on, and we'll almost be ready to go. One thing that I do recommend, we sprayed PB Blaster, obviously we poured fluid everywhere, so clean all of your parts as best as you can, so that way if there are any leaks or any problems in the future, they're going to be very evident and readily noticeable. You torqued everything to spec, shouldn't have any issues, but it's always a good idea to have that double check. So we've wiped everything down. Let's go ahead and slip this in. It is a little cumbersome, so I recommend putting the front in first. Slide it back. Make sure you clear all the little pieces like that. And then just put these center two screws in. That'll hold it in place while you do the rest of it. So even just by hand, throw these two in. They're going to line right up. Now you can let go, and you can focus on doing all the screws around. Now that we've got the belly pan on, we're going to lower it down a little bit, put the wheels on, and finish up the upper cowling. We have the wheels back on. Now we're going to put the upper cowling back in. So these are held in with those 8mm bolts. Basically have to give it a little wiggle, and it'll snap down into place. Like that. Now the two bolts that are on the corners by the ECU and the master cylinder, those are a fine thread. The rest of them are just self-tappers into plastic. So just make sure you don't put a self-tapper where the two fine thread bolts go. And these should thread in perfectly. You shouldn't need to force them or move anything around. So if you find that something's a little misaligned, this rubber strip probably isn't seated all the way, go back up, give that another little bit of a wiggle, and you'll be able to get those down properly. Next, you've got your interior air filter. That goes right across the top like that. 6 bolts hold it on. Start them all by hand, and then we'll take the 8mm ratchet to snug them down. Like I said, they are self-tapping into plastic. You really don't need much torque at all to hold this down. Also, don't forget about your sensor here. You want to make sure that that is plugged in before you put your cover for your ECU back on. Okay, and your next step is to put your covers back on. These are side specific, but they can only go in one way, so not too bad. Again, this only goes in one way, shouldn't need forcing. Make sure that you've got all the cords and the rubber in the right places and it should snap right in. The next step is going to put the electrical harnesses back on. These just clip into place. Like that. The last thing that we're going to do before driving it over to the alignment shop, I'm just going to put this interior kick panel back on. It's held in by a few T20s, and then just kind of slides into place. And we have completed installing a steering rack on my E82 128. This will work for all rear-wheel drive E90 and E82, E88, so that's your 1 series, your 3 series, rear-wheel drive, exact same part numbers, exact same fitment, whether you have the N54 or the N52. If you like what you've seen here, please hit the like button, subscribe, and thanks for watching.